Namaste. In this session, we are going to look at cross-validation. Now, let us take a look at an example to understand cross-validation in a much better manner. Now, imagine a bank approaches you and provides you with a classification dataset of 1,000 people who did or did not default on their loans. And when you check out the dataset, you find that 950 of them paid off their loans and 50 of them did not pay back the loan. Okay, so 50 of them defaulted. Now the bank is asking you to make a machine learning model to predict whether someone in the future would be worthy of a loan or not. Okay, so this is what you want to make. So they have basically provided you with a set of features like their income, their age, their work experience, etc. So based on these features, you need to predict whether the bank should provide them a loan or not. Now, so how do you go about making your model now? Well, I'll give you three choices. So let's begin. Option one, train on all the 1,000 data points, where each data point is basically one record and each record is basically one person. Okay, done. So now it is time to bring up the test data set upon which we will test our model performance. Oops. So there is none. We have just trained our model on all the available data points. So now, what would you do? Would you test your model performance on the same data points that we trained upon? Because obviously you want to test your model, otherwise you would not know how good it is, right? So would you test your model performance on the same data points that we trained upon? Well, no, that would lead to a severe data leakage and our model will basically be doomed because we have learned something from the training data and we are using that same data to test our model. So that is totally incorrect. So just imagine that if you get the same questions in an exam from the practice questions that you solved at home before the test, you would definitely ace that test, wouldn't you? Because you know what are the questions and what are the answers. So that would be a very biased exam. So this option is a complete no-no. So you should not train on all of your data points. So what is the next option? The second option is to randomly split the data into say 80-20 ratio, which is the standard train, test and split procedure. So once I have splitted my data set into 80-20 ratio, I now have 800 records for training and 200 for testing. Okay, so these four contain 200 each. So these are 800 records and this is a 200 record test. So now after making the model, we get an accuracy of 90% on the test set. Wow, okay, good. So now just for the sake of it, I split my 1,000 data points again in the same 80-20 ratio and I test my model again. So now because I have splitted my data randomly, I cannot be sure that the data that was present in the training set will still be present in the training set. It may well be the case that it is now present in the testing set and value in the testing set is now a part of the training set. So after splitting again, my accuracy jumps to 94%. Good, even better. So now I just do it again. I split my data randomly and now my accuracy dips to 87%. So amid all these varying accuracies, do you think it would be a good idea to finalize our model after just the first time of splitting and noting the accuracy? Would it make sense to simply finalize the model after we got this 90% accuracy? No, right? So this result would potentially be a biased one because we are basically relying on luck to arrange our data in a random fashion and we are getting this 90% accuracy. So we cannot simply rely on this. So just a small food for thought. Have you ever found a movie trailer to be absolutely amazing, but the movie turned out to be a complete bore fest? Well, this is somewhat similar. So our testing set is basically the trailer and the training and the testing set, the whole entire data set is our whole movie. So based on this small random snippet of a movie scene, we cannot judge our entire data. We cannot judge an entire movie, right? So this is just a random analogy that I thought of. Now, what is my option three? My option three is cross-validation and we are finally where this lecture was heading to. So what we do here is simply an extension of the regular train, test and split that we did in option two. So cross-validation is used to predict the model's ability to predict on unseen data and catch any possible occurrence of an overfitting. So it is also helpful in giving us an insight as to how the model could perform on an independent test set if and when we deploy it in production. Okay, so we'll first look at k-fold cross-validation, which will then help us understand the other types of cross-validation techniques very easily. So the first is the k-fold cross-validation, and we will be looking at an implementation of this k-fold CV on the entire data first. So the first step in the algorithm is to shuffle the entire data set randomly. Okay, so this is not in any particular order now, it is at random. And this k in the k-fold CV is the number of splits that we want to do to the data. Okay, and it has been experimentally found that 5 and 10 are good values for k to begin with, because they do not result in high variance or high bias on the training or testing data. So these are the two good values. So if you are not sure what to use, go with 10 or go with 5. Okay, so now just for example, we let k is equal to 5 in our case. Okay, so our data set had 1000 points. So after splitting my data set into 5 different splits, so we have 20% in each of these buckets, right? So after doing the 5 equal splits, each split is now called a fold. So now iteratively, we let one fold to be the testing set and the other k minus 1 folds to be the training set. So how does it work? Well, in the first iteration, we will let the first fold to be the testing set. So that is, the first 200 records will be my testing set, and the remaining 800 records, which are these 4 folds, these will be my training set. Okay, so I'll first make a machine learning model with an algorithm of my choice. For example, if I use logistic regression, then I will train my model on these 800 records and my test, and then test it on this test set. And then now this accuracy, this performance metric can be anything. I can use a raw KUC score, I can use a precision recall. So this is my choice. So we can provide whatever we want here. For example, the accuracy comes out to be A1. So now in the second iteration, what we do is we first discard this first model. We will throw away this model and we will just retain the accuracy score of A1. Okay. In the second iteration, what we do is we let the second fold be the testing set and the remaining 4 folds be the training set. So again, we have 800 training records and 200 testing records, but here the 200 testing records are different from the first iteration, and my accuracy, I find it to be A2 after training on my logistic regression model. In the third iteration, I will let the third fold be the testing set and the remaining 4 folds to be the training set. My accuracy is A3. Similarly for iteration 4, I will let the fourth fold be the testing set and the remaining 4 be the training set. My accuracy is A4. And then for my iteration 5, my final fold is my testing set and my accuracy comes out to be A5. Now what we do is we calculate the average of all of these 5 accuracies, and this will be our mean score, mean accuracy of the model. So here basically what is happening is every data point is getting the chance to be in the training set 4 times and in the testing set 1 time. So if I check out for any particular bucket, for example this bucket, so this bucket, this was in iteration 1, it was a training set, and again it was a training set here. So 4 times training set and 1 time it was a testing set. So each data point is getting the chance to be in the training set as well as the testing set. So this makes our model less biased and less optimistic. So by optimistic, what I mean is, if we see the option 2 again, we were relying on luck to provide us the best testing data to achieve the highest accuracy, right? So that was an optimistic model. But here, since we are providing 5 different testing sets, we are basically making a model less optimistic by achieving 5 different accuracies, and then we are taking the average of all of those 5 accuracies. So now another variant of this k-fold cross-validation is to train on only the training data. So now what we do in this algorithm is we first shuffle the data randomly, like in the previous k-fold case. And then here we first split the data into training and testing set using the train test and split. For example, we let the training set to be 80% and testing to be 20%. So now we have 800 training data and 200 testing data. So now instead of performing k-fold cross-validation on the entire data, like we saw in the previous example, we will only do it on these 800 samples now. So if you see here, we are basically shuffling the entire data set and we are passing the entire data set into this k-fold cross-validation. So our entire 1000 records were getting split into 20% each. So each bucket was 200 values, right? But here, if we choose k is equal to 5, each fold will have 800 divided by 5, which is 160 samples instead of the 200 that we saw before. Right, so the working is the same, exactly the same. The only difference is now instead of 200 samples in each of these buckets, I'll have 160 samples. So now what happens to my 200 testing data samples? Well, we basically keep this data hidden or unseen until the very end so that we can test our final model against it. So what we're actually doing is we're calculating the phi accuracies. And if we are happy with the mean of these phi accuracies, then we can proceed with that logistic regression model or any model that we used in this k-fold cross-validation, and we can test that model onto the testing data which has not been used until now, and we can see what results do we get there, whether we are able to generalize on our testing data as well. We can check in that case. But it is a pretty controversial and a complicated topic which has both its pros and cons. So what are the pros of this training data example? Well, we can check if a model is generalizing well onto the testing data, or the out of sample data as it is often called, before we ship it to production. And what are the cons? Well, we are missing out on 200 samples for finding out the optimum hyperparameters. Because we are working on only 800 samples, we will be missing out on the data of these 200 samples for finding out the optimum hyperparameters. Okay, so these are the pros and cons. And if you have anything to share with me, whether what is your preferred mode of working, then please share with me in the comment section below. I'll be happy to have a good discussion about it. Now, assume that after doing the k-fold cross-validation, my phi accuracies are 80%, 84%, 79%, 83%, and 81%. So what do we learn from this? Our predictions are pretty close to each other, as we see here, and which can be mathematically proven by the low standard deviation. And hence, we can be pretty confident that on new unseen data, the model will predict an accuracy which is pretty close to these values, right? So our model will be, so on the unseen data, it will be pretty close to around 80 to 81%. So we can be sure of that. Now assume we get the accuracies as 80, 84, 79, 51, and 81%. Now, did you notice that I had a 51% in there? Well, doesn't it look like an outlier accuracy among the other ones? Because all the other ones are pretty close to 80, and this one is definitely not close to 80. So we need to check why it has happened so and try to rectify it. So this is where k-fold cross-validation can help us. It can help us rectify if we have data which are not in sync with each other. So we can check why this was 51% and why this was 84%, etc. Well, one limitation of k-fold cross-validation is, as the data size increases, the time taken for the evaluation will also increase by k times, because we are essentially making k different models onto the data. What I mean by that is, for example, we saw that if we chose k is equal to 5, then we were making 5 different machine learning models, right? One for each iteration. So if we have 10, so if we choose k is equal to 10, we'll make 10 different models. And here we had only 1000 or 800 samples, but in real life, we'll have millions of data samples. So it will get a little bit inconvenient to work with k-fold cross-validation in that case. And sometimes in those cases, a simple train test split can also suffice. So it is just a matter of preference and how much time do you have on your hands. So now next comes the stratified k-fold. So if we see here, we saw a dip in accuracy to 51% here. So one of the rectifications that we can do is we can go for a stratified k-fold instead of a simple k-fold. Now in a normal k-fold, imagine that in one of our iterations, the test fold, which will hold 200 records, ends up with 49 defaulters and 151 non-defaulters. Okay, so in that particular bucket of data of 200 records, I have 49 defaulters and 151 non-defaulters. So now in effect, the remaining 4 folds, which amount to 800 records, will now have a combined of 799 non-defaulters and a grand total of just 1 defaulter, because the remaining 49 defaulters are present in the test set now, and for the remaining 4 folds, I'll have only 1 defaulter and 799 non-defaulters. So this is an undesirable situation because our model won't be able to learn the nuances of the defaulter scenario properly. So why are people defaulting their loans? The machine learning model won't be able to learn with just a 1 defaulter, right? So this is where a normal k-fold fails, and this might be one of the reasons why we got a dip in accuracy to 51%. So that won't always be the case, but it might just be the case, and it is helpful to just cross verify whether that is the case or not. So now enter stratified k-fold to save a day. So now it is extremely useful for class imbalanced step datasets, which we see here as well, because 950 records are our non-defaulters and only 50 are defaulters. So there is a little bit of class imbalance. Now what stratified k-fold makes sure is that the underrepresented class label, which is the defaulters in our case, are equally splitted among all the 5 splits. So how is that going to happen? Well, in our example, we have 1000 samples and we want to make 5 splits, right? So now each of our 5 folds will have 50 divided by 5, which is 10 defaulters exactly, and 950 divided by 5, which is 190 non-defaulters exactly. So each bucket or each fold will have 10 defaulters and 190 non-defaulters. So 190 plus 10 is 200. So that satisfies our criteria of having 200 in a bucket. And thus we will maintain class level balance in each fold. So this is sweet, isn't it? So this is where stratified k-fold trumps the normal k-fold. Next one, we'll look at a leave one out cross validation, which is LOOCV, LOOCV. Now this is basically the most extreme form of k-fold cross validation. So what we do here is we set k, the value of k, to be equal to n, where n is the number of samples in the data. So in our example, instead of making 5 or 10 splits, we will make 1000 splits because we have 1000 data samples. So what happens in this LOOCV is that each single record gets to be a testing set once, and the rest 999 get to be the training set. So imagine in the back of your head, we have 1000 records here. In the first iteration, the first record gets to be the testing set and the remaining 999 get to be the training set. And then we calculate the accuracy of that model. In the second iteration, we let the second data point to be the testing set and the remaining 999 to be the training set. And we calculate that accuracy as well. And in this manner, we calculate the 1000 accuracies. Now just imagine, for a million records, if we had a million records in our data set, then we would be making a million models, one for each record, and get a million accuracies. So hence, it is only useful when the data set is small in size, which is usually the case during the learning phase only, because during the working phase, when we are working, the data set is very much not likely to be a small one. So for all intents and purposes, you can safely ignore this method. Now next is a repeated k-fold. Now what happens here is we just do the k-fold activity n times, where n is the number of repetitions that we specify. So this is just a simple extension of the k-fold. So this is useful when we do not believe one single k-fold accuracies and we want to repeatedly try k-fold on that same data over and over again. So what happens here is, in each new k-fold repetition, we would shuffle the data so that for each new k-fold instance, the splits are different. So if you are confused, let us take an example. For example, we set n is equal to 10 and k is equal to 5, where n is the number of repetitions and k is the number of splits that we want to do to the data. So for the first working of the k-fold, we will split the data randomly and then we make the 5 models and calculate their 5 accuracies. Then next step, we discard all those 5 models and then we split the data again in a random fashion. So now our data set is randomized. Now we make 5 models again on this new randomized data and calculate their 5 accuracies. Okay, so we are basically repeating the k-fold procedure but for a randomized data. So we now have 5 plus 5 is equal to 10 accuracies 5 for the first instance and 5 for the second instance. So we repeat this procedure 8 more times, because twice we have already done this and our intention is to do it for 10 times. So after doing this total of 10 times, we will get a total of 10 into 5 is equal to 50 different accuracies. Then of course we can get a better overall estimate of a model than a single k-fold split, because a single k-fold split will have only 5 accuracies and this repeated k-fold will have 50 different accuracies. But do you realize how computationally expensive it would be? Because we would be making 50 different models in effect. So this would take a huge amount of time if you have a large dataset. So it goes without saying that avoid using it on large data. Okay, so next is a repeated stratified k-fold, and if you just read the words, we have already seen all of these things in the slides before. We have seen the repeated k-fold, we have also seen the stratified k-fold, and we have also seen the normal k-fold. So this is simply combining the logic of repeated k-fold and the stratified k-fold, and it is useful for class imbalanced datasets. There's nothing more to it really, because by repeated, what I mean is we'll make 10 different repetitions. So 10 into 5 will get 50 different accuracies again, but this time it will be a stratified k-fold and not a normal k-fold. So we would be looking at a coded implementation in the next tutorial, and I hope to see you in that lecture as well. So that would be all for now. So thank you for watching.